Love is strong and his grace is free, and the good news is I How's everybody doing this morning? Doing good? Well, we got about another month and a half, getting close to the end of the school year. Hard to believe, isn't it? And is anybody ready for summertime? Yeah. I thought so. It is definitely summertime. All right, this morning we're going to be in the Old Testament book of Song of Solomon. Song of Solomon, that is found in between Ecclesiastes and Isaiah. So if you're searching in your Bible, go to the Old Testament and look for Isaiah, look for Ecclesiastes, and you'll find a song right in the middle of those two. So good to be here this morning. And I was scheduled to be here last week, but we weren't feeling well. And I believe Brother Dylan filled in, and we watched him, did a tremendous job. And then we were scheduled to be here next week, but then I believe someone, missionary, something came up, couldn't be here today. And so they're going to be here next week. And so we moved our time, Brother Bo did. We worked it out to be here today. So glad to be here today. All right. Song of Solomon. And I do want to bow for a quick word of prayer. And we're going to talk about a certain animal this morning. Anybody in here like animals? Yeah. We got an animal at home. We have a little dash hound. His legs, his arms are about 3 inches tall. And he seems like he's about 2 foot long. And has a big belly that drags the floor, and he just loves to sleep and eat, and his name is Cooper. We love animals. Let's pray. Father, we love you today. We thank you, oh God, for this moment to speak your word. Thank you, Lord, for Grace Christian Academy, what they stand for. Lord, just the bright spot they've been in my family's life, and Father, how much we love them. I pray for the young people today that they would really be attentive, listen to the words that are about to be said, and I pray, God, that they would leave this place today knowing that they're saved, and if they already are saved, just guarding their Christian life. Lord, we love you today, and we thank you. In Jesus' name we do pray with thanksgiving in our hearts. Amen and amen. The writer in this little book, the book of Solomon, is Solomon. It's called Song of Solomon, and this book is poetical in nature. It says song. It doesn't say song of a fool, because Solomon was not a fool. In fact, Solomon was the wisest man in the Bible. You don't have to turn there, but in 1 Kings chapter 4, in verse number 32, the Bible says that Solomon spake 1,005 songs. This is just one of them. So he was a man who had a big heart. He was a man who knew a lot about poetry and love, and he intertwined all of his experiences in life in a song. The Bible also says that not only did he write 1,005 songs, but 3,000 proverbs. So Solomon was a very wise man, filled with knowledge and life experiences. His father David was also a poet. As you know, he wrote many of the Psalms. So I guess it's something that ran in the family, a kind of talent or ability that they had to connect life experiences in song form. Anybody like music this morning? I mean, music in general. Do you like music? Of course you do. I do too. And they all have a story behind every song. Some music's bad, some music's good, but nevertheless, there's something motivating that song to be wrote. And so David was a songwriter. Solomon is a songwriter. So the question is, what is Solomon singing about in this song, Song of Solomon? And for the sake of time, I'll just say that in condensed form, that he, Solomon, is a bridegroom. He is the groom, and he is writing to his beloved, the bride. And so he has her parts written in this book, and then he has his parts that he spoke written in this book. Not only is this book about a groom, Solomon, writing to his bride, this Shulamite woman, but it also pictures Christ writing to the church, or Christ's love to the church. And even a little more specific than that, this is Christ writing a love letter to you. He is writing a love letter to me. And so when we read about Solomon and how he's writing to his love, you can insert yourself here and say, this is how God loves me. So this morning when we share a few things out of this story, I want you to put yourself in this song. And so this morning, Solomon in chapter number 1, he gives this beautiful picture of relationship. And it's actually her speaking here. And he records it in chapter number 1. But then in chapter number 2, Solomon gives this wonderful picture of a vineyard in early spring. This is Solomon speaking. Notice, if you would, in chapter number 2, in verse number 11, the Bible says, "For lo, the winter is past, the rain is over and gone. The flowers appear on the earth," springtime, "the time of the singing of the birds is come," there's bird singing, "and the voice of the turtle," meaning turtle dove, "is heard in our land." So this gives a picture of springtime, which we are in springtime now. I love it, minus the pollen, okay? Minus the pollen. Verse 13, the writer here, Solomon, begins to encourage his love to enjoy the journey of springtime. Verse 13, "The fig tree putteth forth her green figs, and the vines with the tender grape give a good smell. Arise, my love, my fair one, and come away." So Solomon is saying, smell the grapes and listen to the birds chirping. It's a beautiful time in nature. Come along with me, my love. Run away with me. So you know what the Lord Jesus Christ is saying to you and to me today? He's saying, wake up and smell the flowers. Wake up and listen to the birds singing. And that Jesus saves, and he gives joy, and he gives peace. He says, come my way, follow me, and let's walk through the spring times of life together, of joy and pleasure. And then in verse number 14, we see that he encourages his love to leave the dark. Listen to verse 14. He calls her his dove. "Oh, my dove, that are in the clefts of the rock, in the secret places of the stairs, let me see thy countenance. Let me hear thy voice, for sweet is thy voice, and thy countenance is comely." He says, oh, my dove, you're in hiding mode. Come out from your hiding mode. I want to see you. Jesus this morning is saying to all of us, God is saying this morning to all of us, he says, I want to see your face. I want to hear your voice. Come out of your hiding mode. I want you to notice something he says in verse number 14. He says, oh, my dove that are in the clefts of the rock. These doves had found a nesting place in the cliff of a rock. Let's just say this is the rock, and here's a little born out little place, and that's a little nest that a dove would find its place in, and it would nestle in there, and it would stay there because it's a protected place. It's a safe place. But Solomon says, my love, I want to see you. I want you to leave your nest. I want to see you, my love. Jesus this morning is saying that he wants us to leave our safety nests of this world. He wants to hear our voice. He wants to see our face. But many times in life, we are hiding in dark places. Many times in life, we deal with fear and struggle and worry, and we have anxieties, and listen, we have problems at school, and we have friends who betray us, and we have family problems. We have all these things going on, and we like to tuck ourselves away and hide, don't we? Solomon says, I have some flowers I want you to smell. I have some grapes I want you to smell. I have some birds that are singing I want you to hear. I want you to come through this journey with me. Come out from your nest. This morning the Lord wants you to come out of that safety zone. Come out of that dark place and experience joy and love and peace that only God can give. Notice something else in verse 14. Oh, my dove that are in the clefts of the rock, in the secret places, listen, of the stairs. He says, you are at the bottom of the stairs. The stairs he's talking about, it's these rocks that appear to look like stairs. They're jagged and they're confined, kind of like a narrow type deal, but they look like stairs. And he's saying, my dove, you are in the secret place of the stairs. You're hiding in the bottom of the stairs. Has anybody ever seen that movie or a movie where the person's walking through the house? They hear something downstairs. They open the door. And you're looking down the stairs, and your buddy says, go ahead, go down there. Look what it, see what it is. I ain't going down those stairs. It's dark down there. Is it just me who's seen those kind of movies? And listen, I'm not promoting anything scary. I'm just saying, there's those times, even if you haven't seen a movie, but just having stairs. Sometimes it's scary looking down those stairs, especially if it's dark. Solomon says, my love, you are living life in the dark down at the stairs. I want you to come upstairs in the living room and meet with me. Some of you this morning are living your life in the dark at the bottom of the stairs, and Jesus has a supper in the living room. He wants to fellowship with you. He wants to love on you. He has something great for you. Come up from the basement to the living room. So we see here this Solomon is writing to his love, but also is Christ writing to us? Are you a cellar dweller this morning? Are you sad this morning? Don't raise your hand. Don't shake your head. Are you depressed this morning? Are you struggling this morning? You may be going through all of these things because you are at the bottom of the stairs in a very dark place. Do what Solomon says and come up from the bottom of those stairs and enjoy my presence. Let's run away together. Let's hear the birds singing. Let's smell the grapes. And so we see that these things are happening. Are y'all listening this morning? These things are happening, and so we have a beautiful imagery of a vineyard. We have a beautiful imagery of relationship. And just listen to me very carefully. We won't be much longer. He now gives his love responsibilities in the vineyard or the garden. Notice verse number 15. He says, take us the foxes. The little foxes that spoil the vines, for our vines have tender grapes. And so now Solomon is given vineyard responsibilities, garden responsibilities. He mentions his love, he mentions this vineyard, and now he mentions there are foxes in this vineyard trying to steal the grapes. Can I say this morning? That there are foxes in your life, there are foxes in my life that are gnawing at us and biting at us and is trying to steal our joy, trying to steal our peace, trying to steal anything that we've worked hard for. They are trying to steal those things away. And so Solomon gives vineyard responsibilities. Just for a few minutes this morning, I want to talk about watching out for the foxes. Watching out for the foxes. If a garden, if a vineyard is healthy, it's growing, and there's fruit. If a church is growing, if a church is healthy, it's growing, there will be fruit. If you are growing and you are maturing in life and your walk with the Lord, if you have a relationship with Him, guess what? You are growing and maturing, and there is fruit in your life. Different places in the Bible describe the Christian as a plant or a tree. John 15:5 says, I am the vine, ye are the branches. Psalm chapter number 1 in verse number 3, the Bible says, and he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water. And so we are likened unto plants and trees. And so the goal is to grow, mature, and yield fruit in our lives and through our lives for the honor and glory of God, who has saved us, if you're saved, and blessed us, which he has blessed the saved and the lost. It's our job to grow and bear fruit. But in pursuit of doing that, there is a warning. There is a challenge that we need to keep our minds on the fact that someone is trying to steal your fruit. We need to keep our eyes on the foxes. They want what you have this morning. There are some vineyard responsibility. Watch out for the foxes. Number one, there's a disturber here in this verse. A disturber. Look at verse 15. Take us the foxes, the little foxes. The disturber of the vineyard, the disturber in your life is like a fox. A little fox. If we see big things coming in our life, we'll take care of those big things because we can see them. But sometimes in life there are little things that creep in. And that's why we're to be a watchful person. They are little foxes. Foxes love to feast on things. Foxes have incredible senses of sight, smell, and hearing. Foxes are clever. Foxes are cute. Foxes are cute. Foxes are cute. Foxes are clever. Foxes will even roll over and play dead while it looks at its prey. And then it will stand up and attack its prey. Foxes are cunning. Foxes are crafty. Foxes are mischievous. Foxes burrow holes in the ground and create what we call foxholes. Let us beware of the little foxes that can creep into our lives that want to hinder or hurt what God is doing. There's the little fox of pride. Oh, I don't need God in my life. Oh, teacher, I don't need your help. Mom and dad, what are you talking about? I know what I'm doing. Listen, this is a little fox that wants to steal the fruit in your life or prevent you from bearing fruit. The little fox of pride. What about the little fox of jealousy? I wanted him. Why does she got him? I wanted her for my girlfriend. Why does he got her for my girlfriend, as his girlfriend? He has those shoes. I wanted those shoes. She's got that jacket. I wanted that jacket. They got this grand and glorious life, big home and nice cars. I wanted all those things. Listen, there's the little fox of jealousy that'll try to creep in your life and steal your joy, steal your peace, steal your happiness. The Bible says, take us the little foxes. Take us the foxes, the little foxes that spoil the vines, for our vines have tender grapes. What about the little fox of deceit? I didn't do that, Mom, Dad. Miss Loudermilk, I didn't do that. What are you talking about, me? I didn't do it. Oh, yes, you did. We got you on camera. We've got you on camera. What about the little fox of deceit? Stuff we're doing behind the scenes. Oh, I don't do drugs. Oh, I don't drink alcohol. Oh, I don't look at lustful things on the internet. No, I wouldn't do that. And if we keep entertaining these little things in our life, they will steal the peace and joy right out of our life. The little foxes this morning. What about the little fox of gossip? You won't believe what I heard today at school. You know what they said at the lunch table? You won't believe what my teacher said about me. You won't believe what so-and-so said about their teacher. You won't believe, guess what happened last week at church? Guess what happened Wednesday night at church? Guess what happened at the mall the other day? Guess what so-and-so said? You know what they put on social media? Gossip. Gossip. This is a little fox that will hinder and hurt you. It will steal the happiness in your life. We could go on and on. The Bible says in Galatians 5:9, a little leaven, leaveneth the whole lump. Leaven causes dough to rise. Little things can become big things that disturb what God's doing in our lives. We see the disturber. Take us, the foxes, the little foxes. Let me hurry. But then there's the description. Take us, the foxes, the little foxes that spoil the vines. The word spoil there, it means to wind tightly. It means to bind. It means to corrupt, to destroy. It says, take us, the foxes, the little foxes that spoil the vines, for our vines have tender grapes. Listen to me. If the foxes can get to your vines, they've got your grapes. If the foxes can get to the vines, they'll get your fruit. Foxes, they gnaw and they bite at these vines. They dig at the roots, trying to pull up the roots. They infect the vine by its diseased and infected system. They eat the grapes and destroy the beautiful fruit that's displayed. If we're not careful this morning, we can allow little foxes to eat away at things in our lives that will spoil the good things that God has done and wants to do. If he can get to you, if a fox can get to you, if the devil can get to you, if your own flesh can get to you, if you let it, it wants to start in little areas so it can contaminate the whole area so that you won't bear fruit. These foxes like getting at the roots. And so they get to these vines, trying to dig up those roots. Huh? If a fox can't reach up and grab fruit out of your life, it'll try to shake it out. Some of you are dealing with stuff, whether you're laughing or not, you're dealing with stuff that's trying to shake the peace that you have out of you, trying to shake the joy out of you. The devil's not your friend. Gossip's not your friend. Social media is not your friend. None of these things are your friend. Hey, say what you want to, look how you want to. I'm just here this morning to warn you to watch out for the little foxes. Because when you get bit, it's going to hurt. And so they want to spoil the vine. And so lastly, here's the duty, and I'm done. Take us. Solomon says, take us. Take us, the foxes, the little foxes that spoil the vines, for our vines have tender grapes. Take us. Solomon says, seize the foxes, hold the foxes, fasten to the foxes. How are we to seize the little foxes? Remain watchful in our vineyards. Let me share something with you. I know we've got to go. Let me share something with you quickly.
In chapter number one, it is Solomon's bride speaking here. And she says, three quarters of the way down in this verse, they made me, it says, my mother's children were angry with me. They made me the keeper of the vineyards, but mine own vineyard have I not kept. She's saying that my mother put me in charge of all the vineyards, and I've been so busy taking care of everybody else's vineyard. I've been keeping the foxes out of everybody else's vineyard, but my vineyard has foxes in it. Let us be careful as we help others, taking care of everybody else's vineyard, to take care of our own vineyard. She says, I have some foxes. I need to get out of my own vineyard. And so Solomon says, take us the foxes, the little foxes that spoil the vines, for our vines have tender grapes. You say, Brother Justin, how am I supposed to do this? Well, remain watchful, remain careful. Keep a watch not only over others' vineyards, but your vineyard. Keep a watch over your vineyard first so that you can take care of everybody else. I'll leave you with this. You may say, I can't catch these little foxes in my life. And I'll tell you this, yes, you can. Brother Justin, I can't deal with what the emotions I'm dealing with at school and at home. They're relentless. They're nonstop. If it ain't gossip I'm hearing, and I'm tempted to gossip, and it's lust, it's envy, it's all these things, it's deceit. I can't stop that. Yes, you can. Yes, you can. One illustration, and I'm done. You say, I can't catch a fox? I'll say, yes, you can. You know why? There was a man by the name of Samson who caught 300 foxes. And Samson grabbed the tails, tied them in a knot, put a torch in the middle, lit it, kicked that fox, went to the city to burn down the city. He set 300 fox tails on fire. God made that possible. And if God made it possible for Samson to catch 300 foxes, God can empower you to catch one fox in your life. Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth me. Do you have any little foxes in your life? Listen, watch out for the foxes. There's some vineyard responsibilities. And catch those foxes, and then you can protect your fruit, and you can enjoy your life. Father, we love you this morning. We thank you, we praise you, Lord, for the little messages, the little passages in